I now have the pleasure of introducing you to Manuel Pastor. And he will be leading the panel. I want to just tell you a little bit about him. He is a trained economist and a writer who conducts rigorous research into addressing significant social problems. And what I love about this is that we have this pool of knowledge that's accessible to us that can help us advance our work, and we also lend what we're learning and doing to that conversation. But Manuel grew up in a working class community in Southern California, especially where students of color were not generally considered college material. And his rise to becoming a nationally renowned academic thought leader is a classic American, you could look at it as a beat the odds kind of story. But in fact, Manuel doesn't think that anyone should have to beat the odds just to get an education. And he has devoted his entire career to making sure that opportunity is not reduced to a game of chance. Professor Pastor believes that community, and in particular, community organizing, is crucial to navigating economic realities that lift up and advance the issue of equity. And Manuel understands that people are, and this is a quote, people are very disconnected from each other. Suburban residents think that they are shielded from urban problems. Baby boomers don't want any tax increases to shore up the educational system, somehow believing that they're going to get Social Security and get through old age without the next generation being educated and being able to be productive, which is a little bit not too smart. So I didn't other them just now, though. It's just a fact. A whole element of our society wants to insist that a gay or lesbian person doesn't have the same right to form a family that they do. This disconnect between people, the othering of groups by place and race and age and geography, economic status, sexual orientation, all of that is how we've wound up with two parties at the Capitol that can't figure out a way to talk together about the national good. And it leads people to make decisions that hurt other people in the long run and with themselves. So it's very clear that Manuel Pastor has devoted his life in service of justice. And I just want to give you a few things that he's done before he comes on stage. He's founded and directs the USC Dorn's Life, did I say that right? Dorn's Life? Program for Environmental and Regional Equity. And he's the co-director of the Center for the Study of Immigrant Integration. He is a founding director for the Center of Justice, Tolerance, and Community at UC Santa Cruz. And he's also written several books, including Just Growth, Inclusion and Prosperity in America's Metropolitan Regions, co-authored with Chris Benner. He's written Uncommon Common Ground, Race and America's Future, co-authored with Angela Glover Blackwell, who we'll get to hear from tomorrow, and Stuart Kwol. And he's also written, This Could Be the Start of Something Big, How Social Movements for Regional Equity Are Transforming Metropolitan America, co-authored again with Chris Brenner and Martha Matsuoka. In 2012, he was awarded the Wally Marks Changemaker of the Year Award from the Liberty Hill Foundation in recognition of his many research partnerships and social justice organizations. Please help me warmly welcome and thank Professor Manuel Pastor for his work on behalf of everyone.
I want to thank you for that generous introduction. I certainly, though in the company of the people who have spoken or performed before and who will be speaking after, including on this panel, feel a little bit like when I was asked at the beginning of the Gulf War to give a talk to a large group on the economic consequences of the war to come. And I was about to get up and they said, well, before you get up, we've got a special guest here. And it turned out to be Ed Asner, the famous actor. And he got up and he didn't give a speech, he just acted, and everybody was crying and in tears and emotional. And then they said, well, before you get up, we have another special guest, Maxine Waters, fiery congresswoman who had just been elected. Her first vote was going to be to not go to war, and she got up and spoke, and before she was done, she said, and I have a special guest, Jesse Jackson. And Jesse got up, he gave a pretty good speech. And then afterwards, I was introduced, Manuel Pastor. It was the loneliest walk across the stage I've ever had. I did have two of my students clapping hysterically, which was actually just made it more embarrassing. But just a couple things before we get started, I'll say two. One is extraordinary, I'm sorry I was not here last night, but extraordinary timing, like many other people who weren't here last night. I was actually in the airport, but watching the television as there was the famous interview on ABC, in which we found out a very startling fact. Some of you may have read this, that Bruce Jenner is a conservative. He turns out he's a Republican. I just did not see that coming. But in the spirit of welcoming the Koch brothers, I'm bringing Bruce into the family as well. So I wanna kind of play off this Samuel Huntington riff on who are we, and talk about how this separation is actually resulting in us sort of othering away the American future, the global future, and withering away that future as well. Before I get started, some of you know me and know that I say this, and some of you are meeting me for the first time. While I'm speaking, my voice might break a little bit. It's not that I'm emotional being with you, although, hey, I mean, what could be better, right, than this crowd and John Powell? It's that I have a voice condition that's called spasmodic dysphonia. That's pretty hard to sign. And what that is spasms around the voice box that can sometimes lock your voice up. Diane Rehm, a number of other famous people have it, now me. And I always like to reassure people that it gets treated once a month with Botox, because that's how we treat everything in Los Angeles. So there's rapid demographic change going on in the United States, and it's something that's been frightening for a lot of people, trying to understand it, trying to make sense of it. And this shows you the statistics from between 2000 and 2010. You'll note the growth rate for Latinos, 43%. The growth rate for Asian Pacific Islanders, 43%. For African Americans, 11%. For non-Hispanic whites, 1%. So 43%, 1%, quite a big difference. And the really striking thing about this, aside from the fact that it's causing changes and some fears, et cetera, is that what's driving that now is no longer immigration. Immigration into the country has dramatically slowed down. Net migration from Mexico over the last 3 years has been zero. There's as many people returning to Mexico as coming to the United States, mostly because of long-term changes in fertility patterns in Mexico. What's really driving it now is births. So this shows you what happened to the youth population in the United States between 2000 and 2010. The number of young whites in the United States actually fell by 4.3 million. Now, that does not mean that 4.3 million young white people died. We would have noticed that. It would have been reported on Fox News, and it would have been blamed on Obamacare. You know that's what would have happened. What it means is that there's more people moving into 19 and 20 than are moving into 1 and 2, so the number of young whites falls. Where's the growth? Not so much in the African American community. It's been pretty stable, with some folks redesignating as multiracial, but significant growth in the Latino youth population by 4.8 million and the Asian Pacific Islander population, 800,000. And that's what's behind that demographic change so often predicted, that the U.S. is going to become so-called majority minority or majority people of color by about the year 2043, 2044. But what's most important is that about 11 years before that, the majority of the workforce will be people of color. By the end of this decade, the majority of young people will be people of color. So that demographic change in basically who will be working, who will be supporting, is coming forward. Now, we've been here before. The change that the United States is going through between 2000 and 2040 is basically the change that California went through between 1980 and 2000. So California really was America fast forward with all the bumps that that brought in terms of our own relations in the state, et cetera. Now, often when people tend to take a look at this, they also, again, make a mistake. You see, if you look at this data, the sort of Latino share, the blue share growing over time, and what people imagine is it's a straight line path, and that what's going to happen is that by about the year 2045, we'll not just be majority Latino, we'll be 150% Latino, right? So California will be filled with super Mexicanos, right? Sort of marching. This will be the real Reconquista, right? So if you didn't get that, sorry. But basically, for us, the change is really slowing down. And where the change is actually going to be occurring is in the rest of the country. This is what the country looked like in 1980. Easy map to interpret. The browner the county, the browner the county. So darkest shade, greater than 50% people of color. You can see the country look like what some people still think it looks like, the Black Belt of the South, the borderlands of Mexico, the Native American areas and Hispanic areas of New Mexico and Arizona. California hadn't really moved in that direction. When you go to 1990, you can see the change. 2000, 2010, you can see how much of that was occurring in California, but now also in the rest of the country. As we move forward to 2020, 2030, 2040, Public Enemy's famous album, Fear of a Black Planet, right, is actually Fear of a Brown United States, right? And it's the same fear that they so presciently talked about, though. And what's interesting about this is that it's occurring now, and the single most important dimension, and one that is going to be talked a little bit by our other two speakers, has to do with the age structure of the population. So for the non-Hispanic white population, the median age, half older, half younger, is 42. For Asian Pacific Islanders, 35. For African Americans and Native Americans, the median age, 32. The median age for Latinos is 27. So 42, 27, 15 years, it's a generation gap. And it helps to explain two things. First, it helps to explain our demographic change. Because when you're 27, you're in prime family formation age. When you're 42, you think you're in prime family formation age. You may be, Godspeed, I welcome all families, right? But it also helps to explain our politics, because the state that's got the largest generation gap, the whitest old, the brownest young, Arizona. And think about Arizona with its politics around immigration, ethnic studies in the schools, and also the fact that in Arizona in the last 5 years, spending on K through 12 education, third largest cuts per student in the country, largest cuts in university spending, just as a new crop is arriving of folks to take advantage of these opportunities to move forward, the public spending is evaporating. And you can see that in the data we've looked at here. This is spending per child in education, and then we're gonna flip to the generation gap, and you can see an almost pure photo negative, where the gap is larger, the spending is lower. So, and by the way, for those of you who think that that's a visual trick, it actually holds up in a time series cross-section fixed effect regression, in which we control for all the other variables which predict school spending, which basically just means I'm right. So, so how are we going to, particularly against the context of growing inequality in the United States? And one other dimension which I think is incredibly important, this is, I think, something that Aijin will talk about a little bit more too, is the following. This is my favorite graph because it's animated. But also because what it reflects is the following thing. demographers tend to think about something called an age pyramid. Lots of young people, and then as you go up through the age structure, fewer and fewer people. And if you watch this graph, one thing that you're going to notice that's very important is that in 1950, we indeed have an age pyramid in the United States. That is, the baby boomers, that were the very young folks, right? You can kind of watch them moving through as time goes on. But watch what happens is that age pyramid is becoming an age cylinder, right? More people living to be older, less immigrants filling in the middle, right? Lower birth rates. And what that means is we have to make sure that every person who is available now for the workforce, for participating in the economy, gets a chance to do so, because that's what's going to make the economy work moving forward. But what has our response been instead? You can read this cartoon. It's been basically generational warfare. We've wound up having an older generation, often trying to make sure that Social Security and Medicare is protected without wanting to have the spending happening on education. We've got a young group that's winding up becoming increasingly frustrated by the lack of educational opportunities, and we're going to need to address this in a very different way. And what's difficult about doing it in the United States right now is that we tend to stand apart. And by this, I don't mean physically stand, but we tend to sort of be separated from one another in the ways that we think, in the ways that we talk. We don't even agree on what's real. We don't even agree on the fact that immigration has slowed down in the United States. We don't even agree that net migration from Mexico, even though it's a fact, is zero. We don't agree. We stand apart. We've wound up living apart. One thing with this graph, which is kind of fancy, shows, but the red bars at the bottom are the share of poor people living in poor communities. The blue bars at the top are the share of high-income people living in high-income communities. And as you can see, people are living further and further apart. That is, they're moving to communities that are separate in terms of their class experience. They're also moving very far apart in terms of ideology. The red or blue in these maps are whether or not there was a landslide vote in that county. And in 1992, which was the Clinton-Bush election, you can see that there were very few landslide counties in the United States. By the time you move to the last election, 2012, fully half of the counties in the United States were landslide counties. People either voted all red or all blue. So there's a kind of epistemological fragmentation of our population. And so much so that we even wind up getting, this is one of my favorite facts, but at the time of the 2008 election, how many Republicans do you think thought President Obama was born in Kenya? Somebody said all of them, that's good. No, the polling number said in 2008 it was 16%. So in 2012, after 4 years of more information, what percent of Republicans do you think President Obama was born in a different country? 30%, right? It had gone up. And one of the reasons why it had gone up is because we increasingly live in a world in which instead of broadcasting, we're narrowcasting, right? We're narrowcasting ourselves just to our own people. Certainly Fox is narrowcasting to its own people as well. And unless we address this disconnect, we're not really going to be able to move forward. And the faith in our institutions is certainly shaken. This shows you Congress's popularity versus lice. Lice are far more popular than Congress. Some of the young people are not going to get this, but if for everybody over the age of 50, the fact that a colonoscopy is more popular than Congress, right? So the faith in institutions is shaken. So what are we going to need to do to be able to move ahead? We're going to hear a lot more of the solutions of organizing and bringing people together. We're going to need to think about roots and relationships. How do we build relationships with folks? How do we sink roots in? I've got some stories about that I can talk about. One of the things I think that's unique that I hope I bring to this conversation is that it's important for us also to bring to bear data for deliberation. Now, oh great, that was my lonely social scientist. So, thanks, dude. We'll go out for a drink later. So one of the things that I think is incredibly important is to realize that it's not just your heart and your morals that are on the side of good. In fact, a lot of data can be there as well. We've been doing research looking at the fact that more equitable economies actually grow more sustainably over time than actually grow more rapidly over time. We're finding out that those places where there's lots of environmental injustice just have a worse environment, right? That is, by disconnecting from one another, by letting others suffer, we're actually sort of wrecking the commons and wrecking the whole. And data can be your friend in doing this. We've been working on this in particular with PolicyLink, for example, estimating what the gain to the US economy would be if we actually closed the racial income gaps. And I ask some of you to pay attention to this stuff. So what I want to do, because I want to be conscious of the time, is end with a story that I want us to keep in mind with regard to this whole question of othering. I went to graduate school at the University of Massachusetts Amherst. And again, I seem to be striking like one person's heart at a time. It's really fulfilling. And I went to grad school in economics. And you know, one of the things that happens when you're in grad school, if you ever are, is that you kind of like you're in your brain the whole time, right? So I decided I needed to do something besides be in my brain. So I started playing basketball, and I started playing street ball. This was in 1980, 1981. But in 1981, so I started playing ball out on the street. In 1981, I was living in Northampton, Massachusetts. It was the second gay pride parade that Northampton had ever had. And the first one had been marked by some incidents. And so some friends, allies, asked me and others to be bodyguards for the parade. And so I was the bodyguard for the parade, marching. And I guess the story's better if you know that I'm straight. And so we're marching, and all of a sudden I see in a corner all the guys I play basketball with looking at me. This is 1981, much more homophobic period. It's sports, and they're looking at me like, wow, right? So the next Monday I go back to the court. And when I went back to the court, the first question that was asked was, well, are ya? And I said, what difference would it make? And for a year in Massachusetts, I played basketball as the first Jason Collins, as a gay ball player, right? And what was fascinating, then at the end, it turned out about a year later, I was coming out of a bank with my wife. It must have been a transaction where she gave me money because I gave her a big kiss. And one of the ball players came up to me and hugged me and said, you're straight, you're straight. But for a year, they had to play with a gay ball player. For a year, they had to act as though the other was on the court and the other was in the room. There are many rooms we're going to be in where there's not going to be a person who's differently abled. There are many rooms we're going to be in which there's not an African American raising the concerns of police violence. There are many rooms we're going to be in which we don't have one of our lesbian or gay brothers and sisters raising the important issues of marriage equality. There are many rooms we're going to be in which the voice of immigrants is not spoken. Are you going to act as though the other is in the room? Because when you act as though the other is in the room, you are embracing the belonging and the opening that opens your soul in a way that can make sure that every room winds up being open to everyone. Thank you. So I now have the distinct pleasure of first introducing, and then I'll introduce the second person, Aijian Pu, who probably actually needs no introduction, but she is the director of the National Domestic Workers Alliance and the co-director of Caring Across Generations. She's probably tired of people saying that the MacArthur Foundation has certified her as a genius, although some of us knew that before. But you know, the thing I think, and those of you who know her know this, is that this is a woman with an extraordinary soul. It's not just the sheer brilliance that she brings thinking about how generations can connect. It's about understanding what people need at the deepest level and modeling for us what it means to be a human being in absolutely the fullest sense. I cannot be prouder of this woman who I call my sister from another mother, my good friend, Ai Jin Poo.
Good afternoon. I just have to say that was a very hard act to follow, and it always is, because Manuel is not only a genius, but also just a profound supporter of social movements, a profound partner in this work, and a profound leader helping us get to the world we all know we deserve. Can we give another round of applause to Manuel? So I bring greetings from domestic workers around the country, nannies, housekeepers, and caregivers who do the work that makes all other work possible. And I want to give a shout out to all the people in the room who do domestic work or may have done domestic work, or all of you who love a domestic worker. Let's just recognize domestic workers are in our midst. And it's particularly important that we're a part of today's conference. This is a workforce that goes to work every day in other people's homes. Millions of homes around the country, unmarked, unregistered. And oftentimes you'll go into any neighborhood and not know which homes are actually workplaces. And they take care of the most precious elements of our lives. Our children, our aging loved ones with disabilities, our homes. And yet the workforce is among some of the most vulnerable workers in our economy today. Vulnerable and, in many cases, invisible. There are no standards, there are no guidelines, long hours, unpredictable hours, low wages. Many of you know this because you're close to and connected to domestic workers in your families and communities. Women like Mirla Baldonado, who's from the Philippines, who takes care of the elderly in Chicago. She's cared for over 20 seniors, helped them live independently, helping with cooking, cleaning, administering medication, physical therapy, lifting in and out of bed, ensuring the dignity of the elders that she cares for. She works 24-hour shifts 4 days a week and brings home between $5 and $9 per hour for this work. And she also supports 5 children in the Philippines. So with those wages, she sends money home to her family who are caring for her children in the Philippines. And that, on top of the cost of the room that she lives in, means that she literally can't make ends meet. And when I talked to her recently, said that she often goes for several days surviving off of hard-boiled eggs and bananas. This reality, while not every domestic worker faces the situation that Mirla is in, most work for poverty wages. And this is a result of a very, very long history and legacy of exclusion in this country. Some of you may know this, but when the New Deal was passed in the 1930s, our cornerstone labor laws, the Fair Labor Standards Act and the National Labor Relations Act, were being negotiated in Congress as part of the New Deal. And Southern members of Congress refused to support those two pillars of our nation's labor laws if they included farm workers and domestic workers who, as we know, were predominantly African American at the time. And so in a concession to those Southern members of Congress, those two foundational bills were passed by Congress with those exclusions in place. And to this day, they remain. So many, many generations of domestic workers like Mirla have been living and working in the shadow of slavery. their experiences of work and of life in the imprint of slavery and the racial exclusion of African Americans. Now, the good news is that all around the country, in fact, in 26 cities around the country, domestic workers are organizing, and they are winning. Right here in the great state of California, the powerful California Domestic Workers Coalition has been organizing for over a decade, and they saw a huge victory with the passage of the California Domestic Workers Bill of Rights. And they're going to need all of your support and partnership as they go back to Sacramento to continue the fight in 2016. And they want to know if they can count on you. They are a part of a wave of domestic workers who've been building power at the state level and have achieved victories in four states, with Massachusetts becoming the most recent state to pass one of the strongest bills in the country that just went into effect on April 1st, including maternity leave for domestic workers and caregivers. So we're proud that we are starting to transform this legacy of exclusion, but frankly, it's simply not enough. And it's not enough because this moment is a moment of profound change. Manuel talked about the demographic changes. The truth is that those demographic changes are changing much about the way that we live and work and play in this country. On top of changes in the economy, this is a moment of paradigm shift. 4 million people turn 65 every year as a result of the aging of the baby boom generation. 4 million people, that means by the year 2030, 20% of our population will be over the age of 65. And because of advances in healthcare and technology, my grandmother's generation of 85 and older is the fastest growing demographic in the country. What that means is that by the year 2050, 27 million of us will need some form of care or support just to meet our basic daily needs. And the workforce that we're counting on of women like Mirla, or the home care workforce here in California, the workforce that works at IHSS, this workforce is working for poverty wages and can barely sustain in their jobs as it stands. We need an exponentially stronger, larger workforce, and frankly, a whole new approach to caregiving to meet the profound need and changes that are happening. And thankfully, the domestic workers movement and our partners in the labor movement and in the immigrant rights movement and women's organizations, we all saw this as an opportunity to put forward a vision for the future of care in this country that could truly uplift and enhance all of our dignity, ensuring that our elders could live with dignity and independence and choice, the choice to age at home and place, and the dignity of the workforce that we are going to count on to support our aging loved ones, and the dignity of the family caregivers who are struggling to manage care, oftentimes both child care and elder care on both sides of the generational spectrum. So we have launched a campaign called Caring Across Generations to bring us together across race, class, generation, and geography in this country to put forward a whole new vision for caregiving, one that increases choice, increases affordability and accessibility, and improves the quality of care for families, and one that transforms these poverty wage jobs that have been hidden in the shadows, trapped in a legacy of slavery and exclusion, transforming them into millions of good jobs for the future that you can take pride in and support your family on and have a real pathway to opportunity. And we believe that this is one example of the ways in which poor and working class women, women of color, actually must, can, and must be protagonists in the future of this country, shaping the future of public policy, of the economy, of the way that we think about the future of this country, and a vision that connects us all and uplifts us all. In the 1990s, when I first started organizing domestic workers, it was very much seen as a shadow workforce, a marginal workforce. Today, the conditions that define domestic work increasingly define more and more of the American workforce. No job security, no control over hours, no benefits, no stability. I mean, does this not sound like more and more of the American workforce every day? Right? It's becoming the new normal. And so in a lot of ways, the conditions that define these experiences of women, women of color, poor and working class women that have historically been seen as on the margins are increasingly defining of the whole. And in that way, the leadership of those voices and those women must be at the forefront of the solutions that we create for the future. And they will be solutions that actually uplift and include and reflect the interests of a very broad, diverse country, the next America. Caring Across Generations is but one example, but we believe that the leadership of low-wage workers, women low-wage workers of color, can transform low-wage work for everyone in this country. And I have a video that brings forward the stories of many of the people who have joined our movement and who see that our futures and our fates are interdependent and see the ways that you can, in fact, organize and build a movement in a way that acknowledges a history of racial exclusion, acknowledges the ways in which the racial exclusion of African Americans has fundamentally shaped and set the tone for inequality in America today, and that we need to absolutely transform that. A movement that takes on and challenges new forms of racial exclusion, from mass incarceration and criminalization to immigrant detention and deportation, that we're actively addressing those things as we're putting forward a vision for the future of this country that reflects all of our interests and uplifts all of our dignity from a place of love and care and interdependence, a future that, frankly, we all deserve. And so I'm going to leave you with some voices and stories of leaders of our movement for caring for a new America, a caring, more just America, caring across generations. Thank you so much.
We are now going to hear from another effort to quite literally cross bridges. Luis Carden Acosta is the founder and president of El Puente, a nationally celebrated Brooklyn-based community and youth development organization. We had a chance to talk just a little bit before. Like anyone that you wind up hearing, there's often a very interesting backstory. He was one of the early members and founders of the Young Lords. And before that, he went to seminary school and was a monk. So he's gonna really just talk about that phase of his life because I'm really curious about that. So. From monk to revolutionary, let's welcome Luis Carden Acosta.
Good afternoon. And I too want to bring greetings from the People's Republic of Brooklyn. Especially the so-called hipster capital of the world, Williamsburg. I know the Mission District is vying for that title, but you know, I think we have it. It wasn't the hipster capital of the world some 35 years ago. The south side of Williamsburg is one square mile of this community called Williamsburg that has also the north side and other sides. And 1979 to 1980, it had about 32,000 people, about half of Yankee Stadium. Well, in that community, we had nothing less than a killing fields. 48 young people were gunned down or knifed to death. It was what the media called the teenage gang capital of New York City. Virtually every week, one young person was killed. Now, I had been for 10 years in Massachusetts. I went to medical school. I founded the Young Lords Party there, as was said. And I was also, and probably my best time, was in Amherst as America's public health disc jockey, Dr. Salsa. But I returned in 1980 and became the associate executive director of the hospital serving the South Side. It was to my emergency room that young people came after bloodied and, for the most part, dead on arrival. So I went to the first elected Puerto Rican councilman in the history of Brooklyn, thought that he would be sympathetic. It was Puerto Rican young people who were dying on the streets. Thought that maybe we could find another way to begin to end this horrible carnage. But I was wrong. He, when I asked him to help, had a puzzled look in his face. And he said, "Luis, why do you care? They're only gang kids. Let them kill each other." You can imagine how shocked I was. Surprise, wouldn't get it. I was absolutely stunned. And then I was enraged. It reminded me of when I was in kindergarten in Catholic school. I didn't know a word of English, and nobody looked like me. And nobody could understand me. But I remember that moment, like the moment with the councilman, when a group of white young classmates gathered around me and, trying to get Sister Corina's attention, screamed out that I had said a bad word. Now, how do I know that? Because they were using the universal kid sign for shame, shame, shame. I knew that. And I was paralyzed. I couldn't speak. I didn't have a voice. I didn't know what to do to defend myself, to basically explain my innocence to Sister Corina. That's a feeling I always have now. And I take that all the time. And that's why I guess I work so hard to try to express the voice that we have and connect with others to reclaim that common ground, that humanity, so that we can all belong. And that's why I responded the way I did to the councilman. I said, I left his office saying, this won't end here. I've organized a development team of the best and brightest in the South Side, artists, educators, health, faith-based, and other community leaders, including young people. And in 1982, we opened El Puente. Now, today, El Puente is not just that formerly abandoned Roman Catholic church that we are using as headquarters still, but it is five what we call community leadership centers. One of them is the first public high school for human rights in America, the El Puente Academy for Peace and Justice. Collectively, we have 30 artists on staff. We're the most comprehensive Latino center for arts and culture, obviously community health and environmental justice movement. We're working on climate change issues everywhere, particularly in Puerto Rico and in Florida, as well as New York. And of course, we are a leader in New York City for education reform with all of the things that we're doing, not only in our own school, but other schools. But then it was just a former Roman Catholic Church, you know, a space, an empty space, well, after we got rid of the pews. And what we want to try to do, of course, was to what the word El Puente denotes in Spanish, build a bridge between young people and caring adults, and between ourselves as Latinos, You know who the other was in the South Side for Puerto Ricans? Dominicans. And vice versa. And of course, building a bridge between ourselves and the rest of the city, particularly policymakers who had abandoned their responsibility to support the development of our young people and our families. And of course, the 500-pound gorilla in the midst of our community was the tension and struggle and confrontation between the big other for the Latino community, the Jewish fundamentalist movement, the Satmar Hasidim. A very, very conservative, even within Hasidic circles, probably the most conservative group. They consider themselves the largest group in the world, and they consider their Jerusalem, or their Rome, Williamsburg. And so they saw Latinos as a barrier to their expansion, and worst of all, El Puente as a citadel of struggle against them. Why? Well, even though they were only 1/4 to 1/3 of the community, they were very united in terms of their political acumen, practically monolithic in terms of their voting power. They could put somebody in or put somebody out. And thus, they were able to control the school district. 25 schools, not one Hasidic young person attending a regular academic program, and yet they decided the lives of 93% of the students, students of color, 73% of which were Latino. And everyone thought that that was right, except for El Puente. They also control the police department. I can go, and sometimes I've talked hours about just how terrible that was. But I will just give you one example. And this is hard to understand. We had been protesting and rallying and crying out for justice in terms of Hasidic assaults. And I'm talking about police officers. I'm talking about young people that were bloodied. Horrible things, right? So finally, a Hasidic man was arrested because he sexually assaulted a young woman in a housing project. That night, 500 Hasidic men descended on the police precinct. 23 police officers went to the hospital. The next day, when a reporter called me, because they thought, gee, one Hasidic member going to jail is not enough, what was my comment? My comment was, it's a good first step. Because prior to the man being arrested for the sexual assault and this one of the 500 practically destroyed the precinct and put those officers in the hospital, there were no arrests. And finally, the biggest issue for us was housing. So we have the so-called Hasidic area now, North Side, South Side, Hasidic area. That area wasn't Hasidic. That area was non-Hasidic Jewish. It was Italian-American, Irish, Chinese, and a lot of it was Puerto Rican. But to make room for urban renewal, a lot of the houses were raised, and new developments, five new developments came up, in which the tenants were at least 60 to 80%, sometimes 85% Hasidic. Again, because of that political power. So that was really a major, major bone of contention. So you can understand, and I should also tell you this, that no matter what I tried to do, how I tried to connect with Hasidic leaders, they had a no-talk policy. It was like we couldn't talk to Palestine, or they couldn't talk to Latinos. They couldn't talk to El Puente. So we couldn't get anything done. There was no communication. So when one of the groups that came to me, called the Toxic Avengers, and they were part of many groups. And by the way, the reason why they could do this and feel so strong about it is because we, at the beginning of membership at El Puente, support young people to connect to who they are, to their spirit, largely through the arts. The arts liberates their souls, they identify with who they are, and as our executive director says, Francis Cicerna, that young people become passionate, have a love affair with their soul, and in that sense begin to have a strong identity and a strong view of what they can do in the world. Well, that was the Toxic Avengers. They were artists, they were theater people, they were photographers, some of them were dancers. And they came to me one day and said, you know, there's RADIAC in our community. And RADIAC, by the way, was the city's only nuclear and hazardous storage facility. One block away from a public school and in the midst of a residential part of Williamsburg. And it shouldn't be there. And it was mandated to have emergency procedures and also to basically inform the community about those emergency procedures. I mean, if nerve gas leaked, we'd have to evacuate all of Williamsburg. One of the plutonium, if there was a fire and a plutonium barrel busted open, the mushroom cloud would envelop all of Williamsburg and would all eventually die of radiation. Is that horrible? And they said that we should invite the Hasidim to the meeting that we're going to have to prepare for moving the entire community to the hearing. I didn't have the heart to say, they're not listening to me. So I said, okay, we'll do it. And what I did was to call the Jewish Community Relations Council. They became our Sweden because I couldn't talk to the Hasidic leadership, and they had made inroads with the Hasidim, and they were our friends. I got a call back immediately saying, absolutely, unbelievably, there's been a new election. The head of all of the community groups in the Hasidic community is now Rabbi David Niederman. He's a refugee leader. He's open to coming. He just wants to know, will he be safe? I said, absolutely. And that night, when Rabbi Niederman walked through the halls of what the Hasidic community felt was the Farrakhan Center, the hate group for Hasidim, the other for them, right? It was like Nixon going to China for us. It was like Sadat going to Israel. We knew we had turned the corner. And the pouring of love that just came up from us to this man so infected him, he tells me later, that he wanted to do anything with us, everything with us. So I said, okay, do you want to help us lead a march for the community to gather people to go to this hearing? He said, okay. So years and years and years of violence and struggle beginning to wash away. Not only did we do that, but and help close down part of RADIAC now, by the way, but also the biggest threat to our health in the community was a decision and law passed by the New York City Council to develop a 55-story incinerator to deal with New York's famous garbage, a monument to New York garbage right in our community. So we got together, had the first Earth Summit, got 1,600 people to pledge, Hasidim, Latinos, white ethnic African Americans, everyone to pledge that they would belong to the Community Alliance for the Environment, or CAFE. And so it took us 4 years, but we finally got a Republican governor to override and undo the New York City law and in the process forbid incineration in New York City forever. So I just want to leave you with this one moment, very magic moment in all that we're talking about. We were doing all kinds of rallies in those 4 years, and you know, actually, we even marched with the Daughters of the American Revolution because we told them that where they want to put the incinerator, the revered remains of patriots who were held in the Brooklyn Navy Yard's ships in the jails actually were there and died, and they wanted to put an incinerator in those graves, and of course they were outraged, and they marched with us. The other. So here we were. It was the eve of Martin Luther King's birthday. It was that night. We were marching over the Williamsburg Bridge, which was ready to fall down at that point. There was 2,000 of us, Hasidim, Latinos, African, white ethnic Americans, Asians, all of us on the roadside of the Williamsburg Bridge and of course, going to the Lower East Side, because there was a group in the Lower East Side that complained that we always had our rallies on our side, and yet it was only the river that disconnected us, and the air of that incinerator could easily get to them. So they saw the incinerator in Williamsburg as a present danger for the Lower East Side. And they were called the Lower East Side something or other. Anyway, it amounted to the word leche. So we had a rally of café con leche. I can't make this up. So, of course, there's 2,000 of us. It's night. We have our candles. We had candles, which kept blowing up. We learned can't do candles on the bridge. And we're screaming at the top of our lungs, "The people united will never be defeated. The people united will never be defeated." And of course, at some point, we switched to Spanish. As you Spanish scholars know, that means el pueblo unido jamás será vencido. El pueblo unido jamás será vencido. And I would see, I saw these two 15-year-olds, 15, 14, I'm not sure how old they were, something like that. And they were like eyeing each other. Remember, there's no contact between Hasidic young people and our young people. They're not allowed to talk to each other. It's forbidden. But they were getting off on, "Hey, man, we're together, man. It's really happening, you know?" And so he was shouting, the young Hasidic boy, "The people united will never be defeated." But then it switched to Spanish. And he tried. Very guttural, yeah? But you know, like, I watched him because he wouldn't give up. This kid would not give up. And so, you know, so he's towards the end of the middle of the bridge, he was saying, Puente Unido, Master Arancito, Pueblo. And by the end of it, he was actually saying, "El pueblo unido jamás será vencido." Thank you.
We have a little bit of time for questions. First, a conversation, then questions. There are question cards, I think, on the table. And if you write down a question, it will be picked up by one of two people who are wandering around picking up questions, and they will bring them to me, and I'll try to see if we can work them into our conversation. Wow. Let's give both of them a big round of applause again. Luis, I'm a collector of stories, so I may use your story as though I was there. I mean, it's just, which I guess would make me like an NBC newsman. I wanted to start with Aishin. You know, you all have been some of what this conference seems to be about is not just how do we transform the structures outside us, but how do we also transform the souls inside us. And you've been very engaged in what's now being called transformative organizing, and certainly the caring across generations is an attempt not just to change the rules affecting domestic workers, but to change the very connection between people. Does that make sense? How do you think about this?
It does make sense. Can you all hear me? Yeah, okay. It does make sense. At the end of the day, we believe that social change and transformation has to happen on many, many levels. Systems and structures, culture, behaviors, and relationships, and also individuals, that you can actually change policy, but at the end of the day, if we're not changing people and relationships, you can always change back policy, right? As we've seen many times before, you can always lose minds, but if you transform hearts and relationships and behaviors and we start to actually come to embody a new way of being as people and as we relate to each other and build our relationships, that ultimately that's when you know there's going to be lasting social change. And I think for progressives, we often talk about changing hearts and minds, but really what we end up doing is changing minds or trying to change minds. Lots of data, lots of research, which is very important. Facts and figures. But one of the beautiful things about the way you do research, and also just about sort of an area that I think we need to explore more, is really in the heart space, the kind of emotional space of the human experience, where it's quite unruly, but actually a space of much more possibility and connection and creativity and imagination, and particularly in a moment where politics seems so gridlocked and challenging, that heart and emotional space can be a space of much more possibility and allow us to dream more boldly and ultimately, we think, organize more powerfully. And so a lot of our leadership work with our members and also in the context of our campaign is about how do we heal from all of the pain and trauma that comes with living in a system that, and an economy that's so profoundly unequal and oftentimes brutal. And how do we transform what's inside of us, in our hearts, in our souls, to be able to do our work and relate to the rest of the universe from a place of purpose and power and intention. And then the power of story allows us to then connect to people who are very different from us. We start every meeting with sharing of care stories, where we actually ask people to share a story about somebody who's taking care of them and the value of that relationship in their life. And I think that between the heart connection and the work we need to do within ourselves, it creates a much more fertile ground for more transformative relationships and more lasting change.
Yeah, I'm gonna ask Luis to come in on this too, because I often think about this too, is the difference between the old-fashioned organizing around interests versus this new organizing around values. So you can meet, for example, the interest of your kid getting a good education by putting them in a private school, but you cannot meet the value that public education is about building democracy without supporting public education. So you can meet interests, but not values. Luis, you brought the rabbi in originally on interests, right. But it seems like you're all about values, including bringing arts in and stuff. How do you move from interest to values?
You know, we have 12 principles out of Puente, and four cornerstones of those 12 principles are creating community, love and caring, which we feel is the fuel to create community, mastery, and peace and justice. You know, I want to say that even as a young lord 47 years ago,
we are. Now you're an older king.
Yeah, I'm an older young lord, right? I'm an old young lord. We understood that there were some activists who were focused on the love of power and some who were about the power of love. And, you know, maybe we couldn't articulate it that way, but we were clear the kind of stance that we had to take. So, for example, we criticized our community for its racism, and particularly for its machismo. One plank of our 13-point platform was women's liberation. Now, I'll tell you that we were part of the original Rainbow Coalition with the Black Panther Party, a white group called the Young Patriots, and an Asian group called Iwakun. But, you know, the Black Panthers thought we were nuts, you know, in terms of our push towards women's liberation. And other Latino activists would say, well, we love you guys, you got a lot of heart, you know, you're doing all the right things. But this thing about women's liberation, man, it's like, you know, that's other people's culture, that's not ours. And so we had to take a stand then about what was really the other in our community. And how do we reclaim women to be equal to men. So we did that then. Today, you know, El Puente is a revolutionary organization because it is about love, because it wants to connect with people, because it can see in the so-called other of the Hasidim a possibility and a humanity that's akin to our own.
There's some questions here. I'm going to ask one before we get to them, though. You know, I think sometimes when folks are in front of the room, there's an assumption the expertise is here, and of course the expertise is in the room as well. And also, we all make mistakes in this organizing from which we need to recover. So I'm gonna ask, and I'll answer it first, so it's less embarrassing. What do you think is your biggest mistake organizing, and how did you recover? Because I think the ability to recover and be resilient and move forward is really crucial. So my biggest mistake was we were organizing what eventually turned out to be a Summer Institute for Organizers from Latin America and Latino Communities in the United States, and it was a university community thing. And in a meeting, I talked about the organizing power of the community and the intellect of the university, which is like a fucking arrogant thing to say, basically, right? Because there's so much intellect and wisdom in the community. And it strained relationships that had to do one-on-one organizing to realize what a mistake I'd made. And it wound up teaching me humility, that the data doesn't really move things, people do, right? Humility in relationships with the communities. But it was a big mistake, and I recovered. Now, Ajahn, I'm sure you've never made a mistake, but if you were to think of one, what's the thing you think, here's a mistake I made in this idea of bridging. I mean, that was certainly othering the community. Bridging, here's a mistake I made, and here's how I recovered, so we can give people advice on how we recover from errors.
Well, I'm still recovering from the mistake I'm gonna share, which is that, you know, we are in our effort to raise wages and improve working conditions for domestic workers and home care workers. We're living in a moment of austerity where budgets are not only not increasing, but they're getting slashed. And so when we talk about increasing wages for publicly funded workers and the publicly funded budgets are not increasing, there's a risk that services can be cut or hours of services can be capped and negative impacts can happen for people who are consumers who rely on that care. And I think that early on, when we were doing this work as Caring Across Generations, bringing together consumers, seniors, people with disabilities, and workers to try to, I mean, the long-term vision is shared of expanding the care infrastructure, improving the systems for everyone. But in the short term, in the absence of increased funding, just really feeling trapped between a rock and a hard place, because we need to move forward on wage and hour protections for home care workers and domestic workers to really bring this workforce under basic protections at the same time that we can't risk hours and services being cut to consumers. And I think a mistake of mine was to not spend enough time really thinking about how do we build into the plan a really robust strategy from the beginning to ensure that there were no unintended consequences, that there were a real kind of collectively thought through, that there was a real collectively thought through strategy to bring all the stakeholders together, to plan together for how we might move forward. Now that all happened, but it happened in a piecemeal way, and I think that the community is still divided on this issue, and maybe it didn't have to be. So we're still recovering, and we're still doing the work at the state level to protect and guard against those cuts and caps on services. But I think that because that work didn't happen as robust as it should have in the beginning, it's been a much harder road to sow.
Thank you for sharing. Luis, I know that I arrived in Amherst in 1979, so I think I heard Dr. Salsa, and that was not a mistake you made. That was a good show. In terms of the organizing you're thinking about, what was the mistake you made? How did you recover?
Well, I can remember that because it was shocking to me. The Satmar Hasidim is the overwhelming majority Hasidic group in the Hasidic side of Williamsburg, maybe 85%. But there are actually five groups. One of them is called the Papa. And the mayor had asked me, previously young lords, I worked in the mayor's office. I was probably the youngest ever, I guess. And he had asked me to create and run an election, an anti-poverty election in Williamsburg. Now, to do that, I wanted to bring people together. Right? It's my thing. And I had a very good relationship with the head rabbi of the Puppets. So we created a Puppa Rican slate. Puppets and Puerto Ricans. And we thought that was fantastic, you know, bringing people together. You know, the slate, I think, did very well, you know, for both Puerto Ricans and the members of the Puppa Hasidic group. Well, that day, he was run out of town by the Satmar Hasidim. He was threatened. He had to move his entire family, and we never heard from him again. So, unintentionally, I put a man's life at risk. I will never do that again. I organize in coalitions, but I always do it in terms of how the members particularly think it is safe for them to move. Rabbi Niederman, for example, other members of the Satmar put out a leaflet against him, saying he was a traitor to the community because he was involved with us. He had a strong enough connection to the head rabbi, so nobody touched him. But that could have turned in a different corner, too. So I'm very careful about how I put coalitions together and about what I ask people to do today.
Great, we're getting the signal that we're going to have to come to an end. And I want to give each of you, I'm going to read one of the questions that got asked, which is a small question. What do you think is the underlying root cause of these societal problems, and what do you think of the need for a revolution to end the system itself? Now, that could prompt an answer, or just please take a minute or so to address that big question or to close in whatever way you think is appropriate for this group.
Well, basically, we don't treat others as we treat ourselves. Do unto others as we would have them do unto us. I mean, it's the golden rule. And I think our humanity is at stake, particularly in these days. I think, for example, we don't connect to the earth. The moral challenge of the 21st century is climate change. The Caribbean will be destroyed. We know that. And yet, it's just too much for us, I think, at this point, and we can't connect. So I feel the root of it all is basically seeing other human beings as the other.
That's perfect for this conference and for this world. Ajin, your final thought.
I would say that in this moment that the people who share our values of dignity and opportunity and equity, that our agenda and our values are, there's not enough power behind those values and driving an agenda and a vision for the future of this country that can really reflect those values back at us, and that ultimately what we need to do is organize and build a powerful movement for change that can actually drive social change in this country from a place of those values of belonging and connection. And there's a lot of work to do to get there. We have to build political power, we have to build narrative power, we have to disrupt the status quo, we have to organize.
Wow. So they actually did answer that question. You said disconnection was the underlying root cause of social problems, including disconnection from Earth, and on the need for a revolution. Well, you just heard what Ajin said. So I wanted to first thank you guys for both the work you do, the souls you have, and the willingness to talk in the way we did about mistakes that we've made moving forward, because I think that that's important. With what Ajin was saying about taking this set of values and adding to it power reminds me of a saying that we sometimes use in my office, be authentic, but be strategic.
Yes.
That is to be deeply rooted in soul and values, but to understand that to change this world, you're actually going to need to move power over time. And I wanted to close then with a quote from one of my favorite new social scientists, Kendrick Lamar. And for those of you who do know who he is, man, that is such a bummer for you. So in his new album, To Pimp a Butterfly, the song I'm gonna jumble some of the words up a little bit. Not the words, but the where do they come. He both starts with a remarkable admission and then moves to something that I think is the starting point for this conference. He raps, he says, I've been dealing with depression ever since an adolescent, ducking every other blessing, I can never see the message. Everybody lacked confidence. How many times our potential was anonymous? How many times the city making me promises? So I promise this, I love myself. Yes. And I think with that poet of our times, and I mean that if you really listen to what he's been doing in his last two albums, says, is that we've got to start from a circle of valuing who we are in the world. Mm-hmm. We have to expand that circle to include more and more people. And we have to expand that circle eventually and quickly to include the Earth, mm-hmm. all of its species, and this kind of huge climate crisis right. that we're in.
Right.
We need to love ourselves, we need to love each other, and we need to love the enormous gifts of this planet. Let's thank our speakers.